We wanted to let you know here at the top of today's episode that Journey to the Microcosmos is now on TikTok. You can think of our TikToks like the fun-size candy bar of Microcosmos. You will still find all of your full-length, full-size Microcosmos here on YouTube, but if you're looking for a quick little Microcosmos snack, you can check us out on TikTok, where we are at Journey to the Microcosmos. Given the many fascinating single-celled organisms that we have seen on our journey through the microcosmos, it would be easy to mistake this for yet another fascinating spiky ciliate. Perhaps something related to a Suctorian, but with an unusually giant organelle pulsating within its boundaries. But this is not a single-celled organism. This is an egg, which is also a thrilling sight for us. Eggs are incredible, whether they are kept within the confines of their mother or, as with this one, released into the world. The egg is all about what comes next. Within its confines are cells that divide and differentiate, gathering in numbers while creating their own individual identities that will become organs and tissue in the animal to come. And you can see the animal moving around in its egg, restless and perhaps ready to hatch. And when it does, it will take on the cumulative identity of all of those cells. In this case, an animal that we call the Gastrotrich. The Gastrotrich has long been a personal favorite microbe of several members of the Journey to the Microcosmos crew. They were one of the first microbes we dedicated an entire episode to, and many of us came away charmed by their hairy, dragon-shaped bodies. But while we were able to see a lot with the microscopes we had at the time, James, our master of microscopes, has made some significant upgrades since then, thanks in part to the support of many of you, and this means that we are now able to see Gastrotrichs in a whole new light. So while before we could see the hair traveling down the length of their bodies and even make out the organs within them, now it's like you can touch them. Like if you run your finger along them, you will feel the prickle of scales and the feathery brush of hairs against your skin. And to be honest, that was our main reason for wanting to revisit them today. But while we are here, perhaps we should revisit the Gastrotrich more generally. If you haven't watched that first video or just want a refresher, feel free to take a moment to watch it now. We will still be here when you're done. But if you'd rather stick around, the main thing you need to know is that we titled that episode 4-Day-Old Grandmothers, because for some Gastrotrich species, reproduction operates on a very rushed timeline. Those species are members of the order Chitonida, which sets them in contrast to the other order of Gastrotrichs, the Macrodiscida. While almost all Gastrotrichs across both orders can reproduce sexually, the Chitonids have an additional approach, parthenogenesis. This means that they are able to form an embryo from an unfertilized egg. The reason we're revisiting the specifics of Gastrotrich reproduction is because it might be related to another fundamental difference between Chitonids and Macrodiscoids, their habitats. Chitonids are largely found in freshwater, while Macrodiscoids are mostly found in marine waters. Scientists have long wondered just how Gastrotrichs found themselves in these different environments. It's generally accepted that the order Macrodiscida is older than the order Chitonida. That suggests that Gastrotrichs began as an order of marine animals, which then went through some evolutionary pathway that transitioned some of them to freshwater life. There are many questions that we could ask about that transition. Where did the Gastrotrichs' journey take them? Did this evolution happen several times or just once? Did changes on a geologic scale, like changes in sea level, shape these long-lasting changes within their bodies? Is the journey of Chitonids into freshwater complete, or did any ever venture their way back to marine environments? Well, when scientists used the tools of molecular phylogeny, They found evidence that the shift from marine to freshwater life happened just once, and it happened fairly quickly. And it may be that parthenogenesis made that change possible. If some of those gastrotrichs in transition had been able to reproduce via parthenogenesis, they may have had a significant advantage as they settled in a new environment. Without having to go through the trouble of fertilization, they could have quickly expanded their population, gaining a foothold, allowed them to survive. Now, we don't know if parthenogenesis did directly drive the Chetanin's ability to transition into fresh water, but there is evolutionary precedent for it. Mud snails shifted to parthenogenetic reproduction in their own marine to freshwater transition. But parthenogenesis is just one of the traits that might have allowed these species to spread into less salty waters. They would have required other adaptations, changes that would allow them to tolerate the shifting landscape in the ecology and geology around them. Scientists have also found that there are some marine gastrotrichs among the otherwise freshwater chetanids. Might seem like this relationship means those marine gastrotrichs are remnants of the ancient gastrotrichs who set the stage for freshwater life, but that's not what the genetics say. Instead, it appears that these marine gastrotrichs are the result of chetanids who decided that freshwater life wasn't for them, who returned to the saltier environments of their ancestors. What drove those gastrotrichs back? Well, aside from the fact that there was an evolutionary space for them, we don't know. Animals have been navigating new environments and finding ways to adapt for eons. Each organism always laying the foundation for new ways of living, building a biology so complex that even the tiniest bits of it are worth the sort of intense, unrelenting investigation that humans are so very, very good at. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. The people on the screen right now, those are our Patreon patrons. They're the people who make this channel possible and who allow us to just really unleash our unrelenting investigation into this tiny, tiny world that so much deserves it. We're really excited to continue that investigation into 2023, and the reason we can do it is our Patreon patrons. So if you want to add your name to this list, you can go to patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there is always a subscribe button somewhere nearby.